Hey, horse people! Man, it's a marathon video, part 7. Wow! Hope 27, 39, 10 minutes. Hopefully, I can get through this sucker.
Yes. What would have to happen is someone has to understand my horses. No,
I don't need to understand your horses. That's incorrect. That's a false mindset of yours. I don't need to understand any horse. I don't need to know shit about any horse. All horses understand pressure and release. They understand leader. They understand pecking order. They know that when I pick up the rein, that I'm in charge. And they'll know it very quickly. And I don't have to beat them, and I don't have to wear them out. I have to do anything. Man, I would love for him to bring that horse up here so I could show him that everything he's saying is incorrect. This horse would be like working like a charm for me. And he'd be like, wow, I didn't know it was trained. He'd be blaming it on training. I didn't know it was trained. Oh, so that's why he's not doing good, because you didn't know it was trained. It ain't got to do with the horse, Lester. It's you. Quit blaming the damn horse.
Oh, sir, look at that. Look at that. He just stopped dead in his tracks.
Why'd he stop? Because he didn't have to go. Because you let him stop. Because you didn't keep him moving. Because you weren't giving enough direction. When you felt him starting, you can tell when a horse is about to stop. I know my horse is about to stop before he stops. And as soon as I feel him slowing down to stop, I'm going to increase my pressure with my legs and tell him, I don't want you to stop. You better keep going. And I'm going to give him direction so he doesn't have to start and I don't have to correct him and make him move. That's the difference on reading a horse on the fly or on a move or on a walk.
And I'm having to nudge him harder and harder. So that's the whole thing, Mr. Rick. Going up to Denton, where you live, and messing around with your horses, Mr. T, I forgot the other one's name, sorry.
Buddy.
Would really be, that wouldn't be beneficial because...
Yeah, see, Lester, you are freaking out of your freaking mind if you don't think riding other trained horses is beneficial to you. Matter of fact, you should probably be riding a trained horse, and then that would express to you that it's you and not the horse. People, look, Lester, think about it. If trained horses were all good, why would we have people that owned horses that they can't handle? I mean, if trained horses were always good, why couldn't we just have a national certified horse training school? Every horse goes to it, and then we would have nothing but perfect horses. Does that make sense? Of course not. Because as soon as it got to a stupid human, kind of like where you're at right now, thinking that it's the horse, they would screw it up. They would do things like ride in one hand. They would do things they didn't understand about pressure and release. They would do things to make the horse do bad things, and suddenly, you know what they would do? They would blame the trainer. Man, the trainer didn't train this horse good. How many times have I heard that in a horse world? It's the trainer's fault. The trainer just took my money. No. The trainer could probably ride your horse when they gave it to you and probably did ride it to show you what it could do. And now 2 months later, it won't do shit and you're blaming the trainer. You'd come up here and ride Mr. T and Buddy and you'd be like, man, you didn't train these guys good. They're looking like shit when I'm riding them. No, it's you. It's not the horse, Lester.
Because your horses have already been trained and groomed and taught all the things that my horses have not. And I looked at your page. I looked at the videos. But nothing addresses what I'm dealing with right now.
Okay, first, I think I have like 50. I don't know how many hundred videos. I think it's 1,500. Maybe, I don't know. I have a lot of videos. There's no way that you watch all my videos. And I know you didn't say you watched them all. But everything I address addresses the horse. Everything I point out gives a lesson that people don't want to connect the dots. Everything is related to the person working the horse and what the person did to cause the horse to do what it did. I have no videos of trained horses doing everything right when there's a dummy doing everything wrong. I have no videos like that. Matter of fact, please, Lester, find me a video of a trained horse that can be given to an untrained person and it will be perfect. Find me that video, because there ain't one. But you can keep looking.
Nothing. And so this has to do, I think, with the anxiety of being separated from other horses.
Well, that is part of it. I mean, I'm not going to take that away. He doesn't like being away from the horses, and he'd rather be there. But his anxiety is coming from lack of direction, not feeling confident, and not getting clear direction. He doesn't know what he's supposed to do. You're not telling him clearly what he's supposed to do, so he's constantly guessing, trying, confused, frustrated, gets a little bit, gets corrected, tries, gets good clear direction. As soon as he gets good, he tries something else because you stop giving him direction. That's the problem.
I think it has to do with being hard-headed.
Yeah, with you being hard-headed, not the horse. By the way, he's calling the horse hard-headed. He's not saying he's hard-headed. I'm saying he's hard-headed.
And that whole pressure release thing is great to talk about, and it's the.
I don't just talk about it. Not only do I tell the video, one of my videos, I talk about how I used it on a kid in a grocery store. It was the funniest damn thing ever. I couldn't help but laugh. I had my glasses and the hat on, and a little kid was hanging around mom's leg, and it kind of wanted to roam around. It was kind of getting into things and stuff, but mom would every once in a while catch it moving away and say, "Hey, get over here," and it'd come back to mom, and it'd hang on to her leg again. And I don't know how old the kid was. I'm guessing, I don't know, 3, 4, something like that. And it'd hang on his leg. So I just took a step in using pressure, and the kid immediately moved into mom's leg. And I took a step back, and it felt comfortable. And it kind of started goofing off. And then as soon as it started goofing off, I took a step in, and it looked at me getting close, and it got a little nervous. And I was looking at it because I was putting pressure with my eyes. I didn't have to touch it to put pressure. I just moved. And even the kid understood it. Kid was like, this guy's getting close, kind of making me nervous. Ran back to mom for security, hugged her leg. It was the funniest. As a matter of fact, the kid ran back and hugged her leg a couple times, and she looked up at me like, what the hell's going on? Why is my kid suddenly jumping over here and grabbing my leg? She had no clue I was causing her kid to do that. The kid didn't probably realize it, but I was playing pressure release in the grocery line. So don't tell me it's easy to talk about pressure and release, because you can live it every day with everything you do.
In theory, it sounds awesome. But I'll tell you what, that's not as easy to put into practice as what some people make it sound.
Very easy, if you do it right. If you wouldn't be pulling on both reins with one hand way out here to the left, trying to control a horse with a camera in hand, it's very easy. It's really, Lester, I guarantee you, if you stick with a horse, I say if you stick, because a lot of people give up, because they get frustrated and they can't figure it out, and they got all these excuses, they got other people giving excuses, they blame the horse, they blame everybody, so they end up quitting and getting out of it. If you stick with it, in 6 months or a year, and you work with more horses than just this one who's got you figured out, and you go ride some so-called trained horses that will teach you lessons, and you go ride a bunch of different horses, in a year, you're going to look back at this video and go, damn, I didn't have a clue. I know exactly what Rick was saying now. I know exactly what I was doing wrong. All that was my fault. I caused all that. It wasn't the poor horse. You're going to feel bad when you become a better horseman that you blame this poor horse for everything you're doing to it right now. I guarantee it. Mark my words.
Pressure release, pressure release. I feel like I'm having to apply constant pressure left and right.
That's what the horse feels like too, because you're doing it wrong. And you do have to cause pressure, constant pressure, because you don't have two hands and you're not being clear. And you're trying to take a shortcut by using one hand and videotaping. That's why it's not working. See, that's another problem with me doing videos teaching people is, unlike Lester, who's actually out there making videos so I can kind of critique and give him feedback, most people will do exactly what Lester's doing after watching one of my videos and then come back and hate on me and tell me, you're full of shit. I tried that halter and my horse wouldn't listen. My horse needs a bit. That halter didn't work for shit. My horse wouldn't listen at all. That pressure and release thing didn't work at all. You're an idiot. You just got your horses trained that way so it works for you, but it doesn't work for anyone else. Those are the comments that I've heard for the last 10, 15 years. But I'm telling you, those are the people that don't listen and stick with it, don't figure it out.
And I'm not getting this horse to do anything without the pressure. All right. I've come to the end of that road. I'm not going to lead him down through there. We're going to circle around the back side of this path.
Man, he's got some nice area to ride in. Nice little ponds, a lot of green. Shit, dude.
You're here. So for you folks who don't know where I'm at right now, I'm on the far right side of my Aunt Joanne and Uncle Raleigh's pasture. This here goes into the deep woods. This is about where the, well, I don't even know if you want to call this the pasture. We don't groom this. We let our horses, cows, and donkeys graze on it if they choose to, but they don't really come back here a whole lot. There's not a lot farther.
I'll tell you what, if you don't cut down these little freaking, whatever they call, I just call them evergreens, but people around here call them something that irritates their sinuses. I forgot what they call them, wintergreens or something. A lot of people around here in Texas hate them. They say it causes allergies. But these little suckers sprout up on my land all over the damn place. And if you let them get too big, the bush hog won't cut them down. So the horses aren't going to eat them. And if you don't trim these suckers down, all this land is going to turn into this tree area. And once it gets shaded, there's no grass going to grow in there. So if this was my land, I'm not telling you what to do or your uncle to do, I would run a bush hog and chop these damn little trees down before they take over. Unless you want your whole pasture to look like this. Anyway.
They don't really eat this kind of mess. Now the goats, whenever I bring the goats out, boy, they have a field day back here. All right, so you can see that Voodoo now is saying, F this, I'm done. F this, I am done, I'm going back home.
Yeah, that's what he's saying. That's what you're saying he's saying. That's what you're believing he's saying. That's what you're reading and interpreting because it makes it look like Voodoo's the problem.
Folks, I don't want to go back home yet. Whoa, I want him to go this way. So, I've applied the pressure to make him stop. I'm going to gently apply the pressure to make him turn. No, he's going to resist. And I cannot release the pressure until he...
You're right. You can't release it. But you're not holding it correctly, and you're not giving him good direction. And he's learning every time he defeats your pressure, he's learning to fight you. You are teaching this horse to pull. This is why people tell me, my horse is really hard. I need to have strong hands because he's hard. You've made him hard. This horse is being made hard because he's learning that when you pull on me, I'm stronger than you and I can pull away. When you pull on me, if I resist, I win. When you pull on me, I can still force my way to where I want to go. You're teaching the horse to ignore you and you don't even realize it. Oh, I'm sorry. Wait a minute. It's my fault. It's think like a horse. Pressure and release don't work. Oh, No, it's my fault because I have trained horses. No, it's because the hooks are on the side. No, it's because his ears are back. No, Lester, it's you.
It makes the turn, or do I? Son. Guys, that pressure release is a lot easier in theory than what it is in an actual practice.
Actually, it's not that difficult, Lester. Once you go out there with two hands, get your hands low, keep contact a little bit, and be able to narrowly give light pressure on both sides and keep his head right in between your reins with two hands. It's very easy to do. You're going to find that keeping his head is pretty straight. And the more you do it, the less you're going to have to need both hands. But this is a horse that's figuring you out, and you're trying to learn, and you're trying to videotape, and you're trying to talk, and you're trying to steer him in one hand, and you're trying to do everything. And it's not working, and somehow you keep blaming this poor horse. This horse ain't done one damn thing wrong the whole time.
Yes. It's easy to talk about pressure release, for horses that...
Here we go.
Very frustrating. I'm just saying, it's a lot easier to talk about than it is to actually do it.
No, it's not. Quit underestimating yourself. I hate when people, and see, that's what blaming the horse does. It gives you an excuse. That's why I'm always cracking on women about pink and in the horse world. Because they're women and nobody can tell them they're wrong, because they've been told they're just as good as anybody else and they can do anything and that they're perfect and that nobody should tell them what to do and they're strong and independent. You brainwash them into thinking all that shit. And then they get out here with a horse, and the horse is smarter than them, and they can't figure it out, and they can't accept it. So what do? They blame the horse. They resort to archaic, brutal techniques of big bits and spurs and chains and all this other shit. And they use tie-downs, and they put these things that wrap the horses around the nose, and they get all these cheats because they're not smart enough to figure it out. But you can't tell them that, or you're a sexist, or you don't like women. So nobody tells them that they're idiots, so they run around being an idiot. Meanwhile, they're screaming at everybody how smart they are and independent and great and wonderful they are. That's why I crack on women. Now, Lester because he can't claim to be the poor victim of sexism, or he can't blame to be the poor victim of what color, or and I don't know what bathroom he used. Maybe he's confused on what bathroom he used, but so far he hasn't played that card that you can't tell me that because I don't know what bathroom he used. So he doesn't have a card to play for an excuse. So I can correct him and tell him that. Now, there'll be people that still think I'm being an asshole and I shouldn't tell him all this and I don't know what I'm talking about and it's the horse and he's really trying and he's really good. I never said he wasn't a good guy. I never said he wasn't trying. I never said anything to attack him personally. I'm saying he don't know what the hell he's doing. The horse is telling me he don't know what he's doing and he can't control the horse, which ought to tell him he don't know what he's doing. And instead, he's falling into it's where the buckles are at. It's because the horse is stubborn. It's because the horse is stupid. It's because the horse is fighting him. So he's falling into that, and I don't want him to do that because he will never grow as long as he has excuses that he doesn't have to grow because he'll have blame. You know, women get to blame me for being a sexist, so they don't have to improve. They don't have to watch. They don't have to listen because I don't know what I'm talking about because I'm sexist. See, I mean, that's the problem, a big problem in the horse world.
I'm winding up this video, and I have a question. Is it possible to have a horse that actually requires both hands?
I've been saying hold to him. Almost all horses, I ride with two hands. A lot of people will tell you, you know, you watch these cowboy movies that ride in one hand. Everybody that rides one hand usually has a big-ass shank bit that causes pain. They have some sort of metal in a horse's mouth. And that's why they can use one hand, because the pain that they can create with one hand is able to control the horse easier when you're using one hand. When you're using a rope halter or not a pain, then you need to give clearer directions and you have to be more actively involved in controlling your horse. So therefore, riding with one hand, and it's very possible, there's a lot of people that ride in Bozales and rope halters. I ride my horses with one hand sometime, but it's still, two hands will always give you better control. Why? Because it's clearer and easier for the horse. It just makes it easier. If you make it easier on a horse, it becomes easier on you. You're making it difficult on a horse, and you're saying this is a rough ride. Your arm's getting tired of pulling because you're allowing the horse to pull, and you haven't tried two hands.
One on each side of.
So again, his question was phrased, has a horse problem? Is it possible to have a horse that requires two hands? It's not a horse issue. Every time you blame the horse, you tell me you're not getting it. And that is your biggest hurdle. I'm telling you, every person, as soon as they accept that when a horse messes up, it's my fault, their horsemanship jumps like five levels because they just finally get it and they stop making excuses. And they have to change what they do. As long as you can blame the horse, you don't have to change what you're doing. You can keep riding around one hand and a camera and blaming horses. You'll never have to change. That's what you don't want to do, Lester.
The rein, because they actually require a whole lot more pressure than others. I mean,
it's not pressure. It's clear direction. And clear direction is pressure, but don't get confused. He doesn't need more pressure. He needs more correct pressure.
And I picture the little horse in Sleepy Hollow, the one that belonged to Ichabod Crane, that little dumpy horse. Sorry, no offense.
Damn. Look at that damn horse.
Ichabod Crane.
They've got this horse in a video. This horse is so underweight. His hips are shown. He's bony. Holy shit. This dude's too damn big for the horse. No damn wonder there's so much ignorance. They're riding freaking movies like this, programming kids to think this is normal. Look at the shoulder bones. This horse is freaking almost skin and bone. Oh, maybe he's sitting on this stone. I never saw the movie, so I don't know. Anyway.
That little dumpy horse. Sorry, no offense to dumpy horse people. But yeah, that was the horse you can ride with.
Is a donkey horse a mule? Is that what he's saying? Is he being funny? I don't know. Or is there a donkey horse that I don't know about?
One hand. If any hands, Ichabod rode that horse without using any hands at some point. But could it be possible?
Lester, do not ever learn anything from Disney or Hollywood. I've done so many videos critiquing Hollywood movies that use horses on the lack of horsemanship skills. They cut one scenes, they use horses that they have an experienced rider do the act 5 or 10 times. The horse knows what's going to happen. They do it 5, 6 times. They do it right before the scene. Then they put the dummy actor on the back of the horse, and the horse pretty much knows what to do, and all the actor has to do on is stay on and not screw up the horse, and that's the scene. Never take riding tips from Hollywood, sports, sporting events, racing, polo, all that shit, or Disney. They all don't know what the hell they're doing.
That some horses actually require two hands, kind of like this here. And so you can have a constant pull.
Okay. He's perfect. He's got two hands. He's keeping the horse. Notice how the horse's head immediately went straight and stayed straight. As soon as he's got two hands on a rein, and I don't know how the hell he's doing that. What are you doing, carrying a camera in your teeth? Where's the camera at? How's he got two hands on that? Anyway, notice the horse's head immediately got straight and stayed straight. He was giving it good, clear direction. I'm not saying he has to ride like this all the time, but he has to be able to give the horse direction when the horse turns. He could loosen these reins by 1 inch and stop pressure, and the horse wouldn't feel it, and the horse wouldn't turn. And if he did turn, as soon as he turned a little bit, that 1 inch slack would come out of this, and all he would have to do is hold. And the horse could only move his head 1 inch. If he put 2 inches of slack in both sides, the horse could only move his head 2 inches this way or 2 inches this way. He could just lock his hands up with 2 inches of slack, and the horse could only move his head 2 inches both ways. He lets the horse drop and move his head 6 inches or 12 inches or 2 feet each direction, turn around, and then wants to blame the horse.
Kind of like this here. And so you can have a constant pull to the left.
You should not be pulling to the left. He should be keeping just enough slack to where if he turns any way than straight, he hits a wall. Almost like these two ropes are at a certain distance and he can't turn his head either way without getting pressure. I mean, that's ideally what you want. And when you're learning later, you won't have to do that because you guys will have an established pattern. You'll have what you like to call a trained horse, when in fact he's not trained. You two have just learned to understand each other's direction and language, and y'all can talk to each other with less because he's got used to you. That's what your definition of a trained horse will be.
Left or to the right, based on where you want them to go and how resistant they are to go in there. It's another reason why I think that me driving to Denton to sit down and talk to Rick and then go out and have some hands-on with his horses might not be the best thing for me, because those are his horses. Those horses have been well-groomed. Those horses know.
Dude, stop saying that. If you want to drive out here, drive your ass out here. And I'm telling you, you're going to learn a lot of shit. Watch that 6-part series on my buddy Pat riding Mr. T for the first time and watch how much he improves in less than an hour and a half of riding from the first video to the last video, and you'll be like, holy shit. Most people who watch that series are pretty shocked that he got as good as he did in amount of time. Now, a lot of people are often shocked at the way I talked to him and I was too hard on him. And I was too direct, and I was too mean, whatever. He learned.
Oh, all the things that my horses don't. So, yeah, because I think that all horses are a little bit different. And so I'm sure they're all different.
Actually, they're not as different as you think. They're all pressure release prey animals with herd instincts. They're not a lot as different as you think. A lot of them have learned bad habits and bad lessons from people that didn't know what they were doing, kind of like this horse is learning. He doesn't have to listen to you. But again, I could get on this horse and he would look like a different horse. You'd be like, holy shit, he's not doing it. He wasn't doing any of that shit for you. I wonder why. Because I know timing, feel, rhythm, pressure, and release. I know how to give clear directions. I know how to focus on a horse and give direction. It's almost second nature. I've done it enough to where I don't have to think about a lot. So because I don't have to think about it, my corrections and my minor deviations and when I give cues is kind of cut down. There's not that lag time where you have to think about everything. You have to think about where your hands are at, how much pulling, how much you're thinking pressure and release, where you're going, you're thinking camera, you're thinking talking, you're thinking explaining, asking questions, you're doing all these other things. I can do some of those things while I'm writing because a lot of my writing is second nature. It's become muscle memory. I can read a horse a little bit quicker and react quicker, not because I'm special or perfect or wonderful. It's because I've done it for so long. In police world, we call it perishable skills. Shooting, using a baton, vehicle driving, those are all what's called perishable skills. If I take you out on a skid pad and I train you for a week on how to run a car, ram a car, spin out, how to race through a city, and how not to crash, I can spend a week with you, and when you leave, you will be at your top. But then you go out on a road and you work for 5 or 10 years, and if you don't get in a pursuit every day or every week or every month, or you may only get in 1 or 2 pursuits of a year, those skills deteriorate. And because it's a perishable skill, you get less effective at it. So the people that rode horses at Walmart as a kid, and then they had their moms enter them in some freaking pony 4-H club, so they put 14 pink ribbons on their wall, and suddenly they're running around telling everybody they're a horse trainer. Doesn't work that way. Horse handling skills, etc., is perishable. Even when I get on a horse now, if I haven't been on a horse in 6 months or a year, there's a little bit of a learning curve. Now, it happens quick because it comes back to me because I already have the foundation and everything. But there's still a little bit, oh, man, I got to get my hands right. I got to get back in the thing. When I'm riding every day, I don't think about any of that. Everything just becomes natural. You're at the learning stage. Horse riding is a perishable skill. You haven't even got to the skill to be competent or proficient yet, and yet you're out here trying to videotape ride with one hand in a rope halter and try to keep a horse back from going to where he wants to go around other animals. It's like trying to teach physics to some, you know, third grader that just learned addition in mathematics. And you go, okay, you got 3 + 3 = 6. Okay, we're going to get down a little bit of physics here, okay? And they'd be like, what the hell, E=MC? What? Letters? What? You would totally confuse the kid, and he would probably give up and say, I'll never learn this. I'm done. That's kind of what you did here. You went from freaking simple addition and trying to get into freaking advanced mathematics.
All right. A lot more questions than I have answers for, folks. All right. Well, I'm going to go ahead and dismount right here. I will walk a little bit further up. He's excited about getting back to the barn, getting all this stuff off of him, getting a little snack. Well, all right. Hold on. Whew. Boy, I tell you what. That was not easy.
Okay. He did tuck that in. Remember at the first, I said I wish he would have done that. Good job there.
That was not.
He switched the
stuff off of him. I'm getting a little snack. Well, all right, hold on.
He did switch these little things to the side. I think that was a mistake. Again, more confusion for the horse. If I'm failing up here because I'm doing stupid shit, maybe I'll just confuse the horse more and start moving. The horse was getting direction here. He was probably just starting to figure out direction here, and then he moved it to here, thinking that was the problem, because he was looking for problems everywhere except in the mirror.
Whew. Boy, I tell you what, that was not easy. That was not easy. Come on.
That's good. Shouldn't be easy.
I'm just going to follow me in. See, here's the thing. He knows the routine. He knows what's up. He knows where we get fed. Back. But,
why does he know the routine? Because he's done it a lot of times. You've made it a routine. When you make something routine, the horse learns that they do it better. You haven't ridden him a lot. You haven't done a routine. If you ride this horse the same way every day for a week, you're going to notice at the end of the week, he's going to know the route pretty well. He's going to know what's going to happen. You're going to have less resistance because he knows the routine.
I don't know. A lot more questions I have answers for. I'm coming. Let me get his food and stuff, folks. Get my tripod set up, and we'll end this video.
What's up, boy?
Kids on a four-wheeler, Texas horses. That's good Texas life there.
What's up, guys? All right, folks. So, I'm done with that ride, and I would say for the most part, it was quite the disaster. As far as pressure and release goes. And I would like to, for anyone that can give out some pointers or some advice, let's just talk about that today, because that was the main focus. I'm sure there's some folks that are going to say, you can talk about the whole saddling and the lack of not having a bit or a hackamore, just using the rope halter or the leads, I mean, attached to the halter. Forget the pink pad. That was a joke. That was a joke for...
I get it, brother.
For Rick. Hey, babe. But here's the focus today, is the whole pressure and release. The fact that when you release pressure on this horse...
Now, see, when he showed pressure release right here, he used two hands. Hey. Watch this.
But here's the focus today, is the whole pressure...
See? Even when he's explaining it, he's using two hands. But when he was riding, he was doing it one hand holding the camera. So, I mean, the conflict in the body, I'm reading his body language, just like when he got on him. Remember he reached for the reins, then he took it off. So he's got some pretty good instincts or natural things that he's either learned or that he knows is right, but he's not putting them into practice.
Pressure and release, the fact that when you release pressure on this horse, he does what he wants to do.
No, every horse, if they don't get clear direction, does what they want to. If they don't know, it's not this horse. See, he's still thinking it's this horse because it's not trained and my horses would be easy. Man, I'd laugh my ass off if he got on Mr. T. Mr. T's too old. I might let him ride him a little bit just to feel the power, but Buddy would be wearing his ass out like this horse, probably worse than this horse.
If I apply pressure, in effect showing him who, I hate to even say it, who the boss is, then I have control.
Okay, another thing that people will say is when you have dry spots on a horse, if they're not sweating equally, that means your equipment is bad or you got tight things. Like right here, it looks a little dry maybe. His cinch was maybe too tight. Normally, the horse will sweat where the pad's at, the saddle. If there was a big dry, I can't tell on this horse, but if there was a big dry spot right here, that usually means you have a lot of pressure in that area. So when you unsaddle your horse, you kind of want to look at it, make sure there's no dry spots. If there is a dry spot, figure out why that is.
Full on, always pressure. It was just a little bit of pressure and he would go, but every once in a while she would have to remind him. Remember that?
Y'all see that?
Face pressure. It was just a...
I didn't see it. I was trying to figure out what she said. What did he do? Let me put this back to normal. I'll put it 125.
A little bit of pressure and he would go, but every once in a while she would have to remind him. Remember that?
Y'all see that?
I was watching her. I didn't see it again because she was. I was trying to figure out. I think she's saying something about he wasn't giving him enough pressure or something. But did he just walk under that horse? I think he did.
Pressure and he would go, but every once in a while she would.
She's like, "Look, dummy, I'm talking to you. Why are you trying to climb?" Good job, Lester. You go, boy. He snuck right underneath there. Now, I don't know if he worked with him or he just snuck. If he just snuck, that probably wasn't the best way to teach the horse. But if he tried that before and he did it again, that's cool. Good for you.
See that? I'm too old for this, Jamie. I think we're showing off.
I freaking love it. Good job, Mama. Now, look, a lot of people will be, what's the purpose of that? What? Look. Sometimes you may have to doctor a horse. Sometimes you have to inspect. Sometimes my horse is causing things. I got to get under and look in between where his leg connects in the sheath area and figure out what's going on. Is there a bite? Is there a swollen? I may need to doctor something. Being able to get under your horse does a lot of things. One, it shows confidence in you and your horse. One, it teaches the horse that, hey, it's okay if somebody's underneath me. I don't have to freak out. Two, if a child ends up walking or gets under there or a balloon blows under there, it's not the first time. So a lot of people will say you don't need to do that because they're scared to do it and they can't do it. So they will discourage other people from doing it because it makes them look bad. Kind of like standing on a horse. A lot of people want, you don't need to do that, stranger. You shouldn't do that, but whatever. Look, the fact that he's doing that is good for the horse. It's good for him. And I think it's making a horse a better all-around horse. Good job, Lester.
Rick was showing off in his video what he can do with his horses.
Actually, I wasn't showing off. I was trying to make a point. But anyway.
It's not about trust here, folks. That's the whole thing. I think that people think that I'm some kind of a, I don't establish the groundwork and all the trust and all that kind of stuff. It's not that. It's just, if I apply pressure with two hands, like a steering wheel, picture a steering wheel on a school bus, you can't drive it with one hand. You can try. But you hold on with one hand, it's going to pull you left or pull you right. If I one hand him and releasing the pressure, he hears me left.
Exactly. He's got it. He knows, but he didn't correct it. He didn't get it while he was doing it to help the horse. Instead, he reinforced that bad habit on the horse during its ride.
All right, folks, if we could focus today's video on the pressure and release aspect of riding Voodoo, that would be beneficial to me and, you know, my learning, coaching. Let's not focus on the saddle, the pad, the lack of bridle, just using the reins and halter and whatnot. I will recap exactly what I was just telling Jamie, that with Voodoo, it seems like if I use two hands, per se, two hands, one left, one on the right, pressure left, pressure right, actually is the only way to make him go straight.
He's correct, because the horse doesn't know, and he doesn't know, and he's not being clear, and a horse is still learning, and he's, I don't know if he's ridden a halter a bit before, so he doesn't have pain, he's got a little bit more freedom. Those are all good things. And a lot of people will call that called plow reining, and they'll tell you you shouldn't do that. Plow reining to run the old plow horses, that's what they used to do. Left rein was on the right hand was on the right hand, you want a horse turn, you pull on that rein, you pull the way you want the horse to go. And they call it plow reining, okay? I call it direct or indirect reining. Indirect reining is I don't have to literally direct the horse. I can lay the reins, some people will call it neck reining, to where you're not really putting pressure on the way you want the horse to go. Putting pressure on the way the horse wants to go is called direct reining. I'm giving the horse direct direction with one rein or the other. When I want him to go left, I give pressure on the left rein. When I want him to go right, I give pressure on the right rein. Again, some people will say that's plow reining, it's bad, it's lack of experience. That's all BS. Look, you can't show me one Hollywood video where they're saying their neck rein and the horse's head doesn't shoot straight up. And I talk about that. Neck reining is a big fallacy. It doesn't work. If you ride every day and you're in a non-environment and you're not given a lot of direction and you're just walking, then most horses neck rein. Buddy and Mr. T will neck rein if I'm out in the middle of nowhere and just walking on a path or whatever and I'm just giving them slight, small directions. But if I want to be clear and I want them to go a certain place, I use direct reining. Again, I don't use bits, so I can't use pain and torture as a cheat. So I can say, well, I don't need a direct rein. I can only use one hand and both reins in my hand because my horse listens. No, your horse is in pain and you hurt him. That's why he listens.
Because if I pressure too much left and then I release it, he may turn to the left with that pressure, very sensitive, but when I release it, he immediately turns back wherever he wants to go.
He turns back because he doesn't hit that solid rein direction of you saying, I don't want you to go past this point. And if you do, you're going to create pressure on yourself because I've got this rein positioned in a solid spot. And therefore, when you want to go right, you're going to run into a wall and you're going to hit the end of the rein. And then you can't go. So I'm not going to let you make the mistake. So I have to correct you. You're going to learn that when I try to go right, after he told me to go left, I run into a wall.
Same thing to the right. If I pull pressure to the right, once I release it, he goes back the way he wants to go. He's not the kind of horse that can go in a straight.
See, he's making it about the horse. It's the horse's fault. He's not the kind of horse. Stop with the horse blaming. You're a horses. Stop blaming the horse. You hate horses, man. You're a horses. You just don't like horses. It's not the horse. It's you.
Straight line, unless I'm applying double pressure, which, as I know, defeats the entire purpose of pressure and release. So, like I say, I end the day with more questions than I have answers for.
And that's good. And usually when I ask questions, I create more questions and answers. And that, to me, demonstrates the complexity of learning horsemanship. People think it's just being able to ride. People think it's able to saddle. People just think you can get on it and ride their stupid animal. And as long as you show them who's boss, anybody can ride a horse. That's not horsemanship. That's bullying and making a horse listen to you. And most people can do that. Horsemanship is understanding and be able to teach and do more with less, not needing pain, bit, pressure, spurs, not needing all that shit, and you can still get a horse to respond softly and with cooperation versus out of fear and pain.
As the whole pressure and release concept goes, any advice? Rick, if you want to take a shot at this, constructive criticism is where it's at, my brother. anyone else, folks? And last thing, please. For those folks that love us and support us and follow our Instagram and Facebook and YouTube pages, please don't go after anybody for giving their opinions. Please don't go after anybody for giving their opinions. I actually respect anybody that takes the time to help me.
And I agree with that. I don't like it when my viewers start bashing and talking and being mean and causing shit like that on the internet. I mean, unfortunately, the internet kind of creates bullies because it creates non-accountability. You can be anonymous. You can use fake names. You can be the person you really are because you're faking it the rest of the time. But when you get a mask on your face, same reason I don't like cops having masks on their face, because they get more aggressive and mean and they're less accountable. Anytime you lose accountability with power, you're going to get more brutal power. People on the internet have power when they can change your name and lie about their name and use fake names and this and that. They suddenly have all this power to where they don't have accountability, and their meanness and bitterness and hatefulness comes out. So, you know what? Lester's using his real name. I'm using my real name. And we're out here trying to do something good for horses. It's not about hating on me or him or Jamie or Pink or any. I mean, look, I crack on Pink a lot, and most people get it. But look, it's really at the end of the day, people are going to learn from what me and Lester are doing. He's going to learn. He may not agree with everything, and he may not, enact everything that I tell him. But he's still going to have a better understanding of the horse. It's not only going to help him, it's going to help his horses. It's going to help every horse he rides. It's going to help him. I can't tell you the number of people on my cop channel that watch my horse videos and say, man, watching these horse videos and understand horses makes me a better person. I understand people better. Because horses force you, if you learn, to get out of your I'm human, I'm superior, I'm smartest, I know every damn thing. And it forces you to get into why a horse does what he does. He's a prey animal. He's a herd animal. He's flight or fight. It's not, he doesn't think. It's not logic. It's not about friends. It's not about hate. It's not about bitterness. It's not about getting even. Horses do not think about that shit at all. They care about what you do and what they have to do and their survival. And that's about it. They're actually very simple, but they're very complex because they're quick thinkers, they're learners, and they're so attuned to their environment because they don't want to get eaten or get hurt, that they absolutely notice every stinking small change. They are the masters of reading body language. A horse could interview a criminal and tell if he's lying better than any human ever, because their life depends on knowing what's a threat and what's not. Their life depends on noticing if there's a hole in the ground, where their back foot steps over something or through something. They learn and observe and remember everything around them, which is why when you put something new, they freak out and they got to go test it and they're worried about it and they snort and they get scared. Until they prove it's safe, it's a threat. They are the master survivals, and they learn body language and they learn humans. So when you're insecure, scared, you don't do things consistent, you're inconsistent, you're having a bad day, you're talking on the phone, you're not paying attention, you're screaming at somebody else, you try to correct another horse. I always talk about somebody working with two horses. It's horrible because you cannot correct a horse when there's multiple horses. When you correct a horse, you correct all the horses because they all hear it and they all read your body language. So anybody that tries to work with multiple horses, very, very difficult to correct. So anyway, great series. Hopefully you get something out of it. This is 43 minutes. It's the longest. Lester, hopefully you get something out of this. If you watch it all, if not, somebody else will. It's all good. Thanks for making a video. And hey, I'll wait for your next one. We'll end that there.
And the things that I don't know. So with that being said, I want to thank y'all. I know it was a long video. And for those that took time.
Shit, if you think yours is long, wait till you get to my 6-part 30-minute series. All right, I'm going to end that there. Lester, have a good one. Jamie, you too. Later.